Good morning all. Welcome to the class of EE306 Power System Analysis under KTU. Today we'll be discussing the topics in Module 6, Power System Stability. So in Module 6, basically the module is all about power system stability analysis. The stability considerations have been recognized as an essential part in power system planning. So there are two forms of instability in power system. The stalling of asynchronous loads. Asynchronous loads may stall off. That is asynchronous loads like our loads, like all motors, etc. connected load. That is called the voltage stability or load stability. And the loss of synchronism between many alternators or synchronous machines which are connected, that is called the synchronous stability. Okay, one is called the voltage stability and the other is called the synchronous stability. You may have seen that in textbooks, like different chapters like voltage stability and synchronous stability. Voltage stability means the stalling of, instability means the stalling of asynchronous loads. And if there is a loss of synchronism between synchronous machines, that is called the synchronous stability. Okay. With interconnected systems, we know that power system is a large interconnected system. And with interconnected systems continually growing in size and extending over vast geographical regions, it is becoming more difficult to maintain synchronism between various parts of a power system. There, the stability is a major issue. So for secure operation of the system, power system should be stable. You may have gone through the news like blackouts and some in the verge of instability, so many things related with that. So all those blackouts across the globe, those are caused by the system instability. Stability of a power system is its ability to return to normal or stable operating conditions after having been subjected to some form of disturbance. So as a whole, we could say stability of a power system as its ability to return to normal state or stable operating condition after having been subjected to any form of disturbances. Disturbances may be load changes, fault, switching operation, loss of excitation, etc. Power system stability fundamentally refers to the ability of system to remain in synchronism. We can say it in one word. Okay. Synchronous machines in synchronism with connected devices keeping frequency and phase sequence the same. So prime concerns of stability considerations or conditions are maintaining synchronism during steady state condition. Second, regaining equilibrium after a disturbance. The power system is an extremely nonlinear and dynamic system with operating parameters continuously varying. So stability is a function of the initial operating condition and the nature of the disturbance. Power systems are continuously subjected to small disturbances in the form of load changes, that you know. The system must be in a position to adjust to the changing conditions and operate satisfactorily. The system must withstand, along with that, the system must withstand large disturbances which are occurring by fault, etc., which may even cause structural changes due to isolation of some faulted elements. Some entire grid may be fault, may become isolated and all. So a power system in normal case will be stable for a particular disturbance and unstable for another disturbance. We can't predict it. It is impossible to design a system which is stable under all disturbances. But what we power engineers do is we design to be stable under those disturbances which have a high degree of occurrence. The response to a disturbance is extremely complex and involves practically all the equipment of the power system. All the equipment in the sense, if there is a disturbance which actually cause what is, for example, a short circuit leading to line isolation by circuit breakers will cause variations in the power flow, network bus voltages, generator rotor speeds. Voltage variations again will actuate the voltage regulators in the system, and generator speed variations will actuate the prime mover governors. Voltage and frequency variations will affect the system loads. All those things we have dealt with in the previous modules. In stable systems, practically all generators and loads remain connected, even though parts of the system may be isolated to preserve bulk operation. On the other hand, an unstable system condition could lead to cascading outages. When the one system goes to instability, it becomes a cumulative process and the shutdown of a major portion of the power system. And the dynamics of a power system are basically characterized by, as the power transfer is gradually increased, you know that the power transfer theorem, maximum power transfer theorem, and all you studied, as power transfer is gradually increased, a maximum limit is reached beyond which the system cannot stay in synchronism. That is, it falls out of step. First thing. Second thing, the system is basically a spring inertia oscillatory system with inertia on the mechanical side and spring action provided by the synchronous type, wherein the power transfer is proportional to sine delta or delta. We can assume four small values of delta. Okay, so it is acting like a spring inertia oscillatory system. The mechanical part we can consider as an inertia, which is contributing to the inertia part. Major contribution from the mechanical side and spring action by the synchronous type between the power transfer, which is because it is proportional to sine delta or sine delta or we could say delta. For small values of delta, we can assume that delta is sine delta is proportional to or approximated to delta. And because of power transfer being proportional to sine delta, the equation determining system dynamics is nonlinear, as I said earlier, for disturbances causing large variations in angle delta. And there are so many definitions for as such for a power system stability. The IEEE standards which has proposed the power system stability definition as power system stability is the ability of an electrical power system for a given initial operating condition to regain a state of operating equilibrium after being subjected to a physical disturbance, with most system variables bounded so that practically the entire system remains intact. Got the definition? It is the ability of an electrical power system for a given initial operating condition to regain a state of operating equilibrium after being subjected to a physical disturbance, with most system variables bounded so that practically the entire system remains intact. So with this introduction, we'll be moving on to the different classifications of system stability. By this introduction, you got it, like it should be stable. What all issues we are going to face if the power system stability goes out, or what the term stability means actually. And it is a system is a dynamic one, it's a non-linear one. So how to deal with that we are going to discuss further. Next is classification. Power system stability can be classified into three: as steady state stability, transient stability, and dynamic stability. We'll study it in detail. First, we'll be moving on to steady state stability. Steady state stability is the capability of a power system to maintain synchronism between machines within the system and external tie line, following a slow disturbance. So what is steady state stability? Suppose a small disturbance, and should be slow too, means slow and small disturbance, means that of something like that, like that of normal load fluctuations. If normal, I stress the word normal load fluctuations, if that can be considered as a slow disturbance. Okay. So the slow disturbance, if a slow disturbance occurs and the power system, if it is capable to maintain synchronism between machines, here all we are saying power system in the sense it is not a single machine. If you consider a control area, there may be hundreds of machines connected to that system in a, at least in a regional grid. Okay, all that machines will be running coherently. Okay, so if you are saying machines, means the all the machines connected to that system all are all working in incoherence to each other. Okay, that is called the that is by term like machines here. Okay, so if a power system is having the capability to maintain synchronism between machines within the system and external tie line, if there is a slow disturbance like that of a normal load fluctuation, that is called the steady state stability. If increase in loading takes place gradually and in small steps, and the system withstands this change and performs satisfactorily, then the system is said to be in steady state stability. Okay, the load is normally assumed to be applied at a rate which is slow when compared either with the natural frequency of oscillations of the major parts of the system or with the rate of change of field flux in the rotating machines in response to the change in loading. So it is assumed to be a slow process. So under the slow process, if the system withstands, that is called the steady state stability. Okay. The study of steady state stability is basically concerned with the determination of the upper limit of machine's loading before losing synchronism, provided the loading is increased gradually. So we are into the steady state stability studies in order to find the upper limit of machine loading, how much we could load. Beyond that, if it is loaded beyond that, the system, the entire system may go out of synchronism. Okay, so steady state limit, that is the maximum power that can be transferred without losing stability. So we basically concentrate on restricting the base voltages close to their normal values. We also ensure that phase angles between two buses are not too large and check for the overloading of the power equipment and transmission lines. These checks are usually done using power flow studies. Okay, and second is the transient stability. It is the ability of a system to remain in synchronism following a major disturbance and prior to the time governors can act. So major disturbances, or major, it will be a major disturbance, it will be a sudden disturbance, thus maybe sudden change of load, switching operation, loss of generation, fault, etc. Following a large disturbance, the synchronous alternator, the machine power load angle changes due to sudden acceleration of the rotor shaft. So if there is a sudden disturbance, sudden major disturbance occurring to the system, if the system could withstand its stability, that is called the transient stability. The objective of transient stability study is to ascertain whether the load angle returns to a steady value following the clearance of the disturbance. Transient instability is a fast phenomenon usually occurring within 1 second for a generator close to the cause of large disturbance. If there is a, it is an interconnected system, and if a fault occurs very close to a generator, that generator, that disturbance will be that transient instability. It can occur within 1 second for that generator, which is very close to the cause of disturbance. Okay, So transient stability limit, which is the maximum power that can be transferred through the system without loss of stability under sudden disturbances. So the transient stability limit is at most always lower than, almost lower than the steady state limit. Normally, transient stability limit is lower compared with the steady state limit. Next is the dynamic stability. Dynamic stability, dynamic instability is more probable than the steady state instability. So what is dynamic stability? Ability of a power system to remain in synchronism after the transient stability period until the system has settled down to the new steady state equilibrium condition. The period under consideration, the period between the time the governors begin to react and the time the steady state equilibrium is re-established. So small disturbances are continually occurring in a power system that may be in the form of variations in loading, changes in turbine speed, etc., which are small enough not to cause the system to lose synchronism. But they do excite the system into the state of natural oscillations. So the system is said to be dynamically stable. The system is said to be dynamically stable if the oscillations do not occur more than certain amplitude and die out quickly. That is, the system is well damped. It means in a dynamically unstable system, the oscillation's amplitude is large and they may persist for a long time. That is, system is underdamped, we could say. This kind of instability behavior constitutes a serious threat to system security and creates very difficult operating conditions. Dynamic stability can be significantly improved through the use of power system stabilizers. Okay, so the dynamic system study has to be carried out for 5 to 10 seconds and sometimes it may extend up to 30 seconds. The next topic, inertia constant of a synchronous generator. The per unit inertia constant of a synchronous generator is defined as the kinetic energy stored in the rotating parts of the machine at synchronous speed per unit MVA rating of the machine. The inertia constant is normally denoted by the term capital H and the unit is megajoules per MVA. Rotor kinetic energy at synchronous speed is given as Ke is equal to half J omega S mechanical square into 10 to the power minus 6 megajoules, where J is the moment of inertia of rotor expressed in kilogram meter square and omega S mechanical is the synchronous speed expressed in mechanical radians per second. We can convert this mechanical speed to synchronous speed and mechanical radians to electrical radians by omega S electrical is equal to P by 2 into omega S mechanical. That is the rotor speed in electrical radians per second, where P is the number of poles of the machine. So this equation we can rearrange to kinetic energy Ke is equal to half into J into 2 by P the whole square into omega S electrical into 10 to the power minus 6 multiplied by 10 to omega S electrical. That much megajoules. So of this, we have written that expression in this separately, this much in bracket. No, this term we can define it as M. That is half K is equal to half M into omega S electrical, where M is J into 2 by P the whole square into omega S electrical into 10 to the power minus 6, which is the moment of inertia in megajoule second per electrical radian. We shall define the inertia constant H such that G multiplied by H, GH is equal to kinetic energy, which is equal to half into M omega electrical, that much megajoules, where G is the MVA rating, three-phase MVA rating or the base rating of the machine. And H is the inertia constant usually expressed in the unit megajoules per MVA or megawatt second per MVA. So this equation can be written as M is equal to 2GH divided by omega S electrical, which is equal to 2GH by omega S electrical. Omega is nothing but 2 pi F. So this will become GH by pi F mega joule second per radian. So M is GH by pi F mega joule second per radian. Or we can write M is equal to GH by 180 F mega joule second per degrees. M is also called the inertia constant. Assuming G as base, the inertia constant in per unit is M per unit is equal to H by pi F second square per electrical radian. Or M in per unit is equal to H by 180 F second square per electrical degree. And the typical inertia constants of a synchronous machine expressed in megawatt second per MVA. The typical values of a turbo generator is high, which is in the range 9 to 6, whereas a water wheel generator, it is coming in the range 2 to 3. Values of H is considerably higher for steam turbo generator than for water wheel generator. That is a inference. And of this steam generator, 30 to 60% of the total energy of the steam turbo generator unit is that of the prime mover itself. Whereas only 4 to 15% of inertia of hydro stations is that of water wheel, including the water. Next, we'll be moving on to swing equation. You can see the diagram of a generator, and this is a motor. The flow of mechanical and electrical powers in the synchronous machines are shown. This is the power input to the generator, which is marked PM. Electrical power output is PE. TM is the mechanical torque, and TE the electrical torque developed, electromagnetic torque developed, and omega S is the synchronous speed of the machine. So it shows the torque, speed, and flow of mechanical and electrical powers in a synchronous machine. So consider this machine. If the input mechanical torque provided by the prime mover at generator shaft is TM, and the output torque produced by the generator, if it is a TE, under steady state condition we could say TM is equal to TE, neglecting the retarding torque, rotational losses, etc. Okay, so we can write TM is equal to TE under steady state condition. That can also be written as TM into omega SM is equal to TE into omega SM, where omega SM is the synchronous speed mechanical. And you know that power is T omega. So we can write instead of TM omega SM, we can write PM, mechanical power input to the generator. And TE omega SM can be written as PE. So we can write PM is equal to PE, or else we can write PM minus PE is equal to zero. If there is a departure from the steady state condition, for example, a change in load or a fault, then the input power PM will not be equal to P. So an accelerating torque comes into play. If PA is that accelerating power, accelerating or decelerating depending on whether load decreases or increases. Okay. Correspondingly, an accelerating torque will be produced. That accelerating torque, we can denote it as TM minus TE, and that will be equal to J into d square theta m by dt square, where theta m is the mechanical angle in radians and J is the moment of inertia. And thus, again, we can write it as J into omega SM into d square theta m by dt square into 10 to the power minus 6, so that T can be replaced by power. It can be made into the more convenient power form. That's all. So J omega SM d square theta m by dt square into 10 to the power minus 6 is equal to PM minus P. this 10 to the power minus 6 comes because it is expressed in megawatt. Okay, so PM is the mechanical power input and PE is the electrical power output. Okay, here the losses are again neglected, and this instead of this omega SM, mechanical synchronous speed expressed in mechanical can be replaced by the electrical synchronous speed omega SE, as well as this. So this will be J into 2 by P the whole square into omega S into 10 to the power minus 6 into D square theta E by DT square. Here we are replacing the mechanical degrees into electrical degrees, so it comes 2 by P the whole square into omega S, which is equal to, that's equal to PM minus PE, where theta is the angle in electrical radians. So this term is nothing but M. So we can write this as M into D square theta E by DT square is equal to PM minus PE. Okay, here actually we have written the equation as PM minus PE is equal to M into D square theta E by DT square. Actually, one more term will be there, that is the damping coefficient. That is M into D square theta E by DT square plus that damping coefficient, but we have neglected that damping coefficient. So the equation is M into D square theta E by DT square, which is equal to PM minus PE. Now the angle theta actually changes continuously with respect to time when sudden change occurs in the system. The value of theta is given by theta is equal to delta plus omega r into t, where omega r is the angular velocity of the reference synchronously rotating axis and delta is the angular displacement in electrical degrees from the synchronously rotating reference axis. So this is the reference frame. This is the reference axis, this is the rotating reference axis, and this is angle delta, and this whole angle it is theta. Okay, so delta can be written as theta minus omega into t. And this equation, consider this equation, take the first derivative, it will be d theta by dt is equal to omega plus d delta by dt, d square theta by dt square is again taking one more derivative. So one more time the derivative is being taken, so it is d square theta by dt square equal to d square delta by dt square. This term vanishes there while we are taking the second derivative because omega s is a constant. So delta is the power angle or torque angle, it is called, the sync of the synchronous machine. Now in the earlier equation, this equation M into d square theta by d theta e by dt square is equal to PM minus PE, we can replace that equation with the delta, so it will become d square delta by dt square. Okay, so this can be written in terms of delta as M into d square delta by dt square is equal to PM minus PE, that much megawatt. Okay, and the M is defined as gh by pi f, no, mega joule second per electrical radian. So we can, instead of M, we can put it as gh by pi f. So gh by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to PM minus PE. So these two equations we will get accordingly. And we can divide this equation throughout by G, the MVA rating of the machine. And we will get it as M per unit multiplied by d square delta by dt square is equal to PM minus PE. While dividing by G, the MVA rating of the machine, all the terms will be in per unit, no? M per unit is H by pi f, so H by pi f into D square delta by DT square is equal to PM minus PE in per unit. These two equations, in any form of these two, will be called as, is called as swing equation. Okay, so swing equation is nothing but M into D square delta by DT square is equal to PM minus PE, where M is H by pi f, expressed in per unit. And this equation actually describes the rotor dynamics for a synchronous machine. And it's a second order differential equation. And in this derivation, we have actually avoided the damping term, which is actually proportional to d delta by dt. And because of the, it is being neglected because of the assumption that it's a lossless system, and the fact that the torque of damper winding has been ignored. Actually, this assumption actually leads to a pessimistic result in transient stability analysis. Damping must of course be considered in dynamic stability studies. And since the electrical power actually depends upon the sine delta, the same equation is a non-linear second order differential equation. Next, we'll see a multi-machine system. In a multi-machine system, the common system base must be selected. Let G machine be the machine rating, G system be the system base. Then the swing equation can be written as G machine by G system into H machine by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to pi minus pe into G machine by G system. Or else we can write H system by pi f. Combinedly, this we can write it as H system by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to pi minus pe on per unit on system base, where H system is G machine by G system into H machine. Machine inertia constant in system base. Now, in a system, in an actual system, there will be many machines connected and working coherently. And machines are swinging, if they are swinging coherently, how we could arrive at the equation, we'll see now. Consider the swing equation. We will consider it as two machine system and a common system base for our simplicity. Let first equation be, then the first swing equation will be H1 by pi f into d square delta 1 by dt square is equal to Pm1 minus Pe1. And second equation will be, second machine, it will be H2 by pi f into d square delta 2 by dt square is equal to Pm2 minus Pe2. Since the machine rotors zing together, we can't write it as delta 1 and delta 2 separately. We should write it as delta 1 is equal to delta 2, which is equal to delta, because it is working coherently. We can add these two equations. So d square delta 1 by d, instead of delta 1 and delta 2, you can put it as delta. So d square delta by dt square into, it will be h1 here it will be h2. So we can combinedly write it as h equivalent by pi f into d square delta by dt square is equal to Pm minus Pe, where h equivalent is equal to h1 plus h2, and Pm is equal to Pm1 plus Pm2, and Pe is equal to Pe1 plus Pe2. The two machines swinging coherently are thus reduced to a single machine, as equivalent to a single machine with the equivalent inertia h equivalent. This is the equation for, actually, the combined system. This is the combined equation. Okay. So the equivalent system equation, swing equation of the equivalent system is H equivalent by pi f into d square delta by dt square, which is equal to Pm minus Pe. And the H equivalent can be found by G1 machine by G system into H1 machine plus G2 machine by G system into H2 machine. Okay. The above results are easily extendable to any number of machines swinging coherently. Now we'll do some problems of these topics. So first problem, a 50 Hertz 4 pole turbo generator rated 100 MVA 11 kV has an inertia constant of 8 megajoule per MVA. Find the stored energy in the rotor at synchronous speed. B, if the mechanical input is suddenly raised to 80 megawatt for an electrical load of 50 megawatt, find rotor acceleration neglecting mechanical and electrical losses. C, if the acceleration calculated in part B is maintained for 10 cycles, find the change in torque angle and rotor speed in revolutions per minute at the end of this period. Okay. So let us find what all parameters are already given. It's given that the rating of the turbo generator is G, which is 100 MVA, and H, inertia constant, is given as 8 megajoule per MVA. So stored energy, we can find it as equal to GH. So stored energy is GH. Means we could find 100 into 8, which is 800 megajoules. And second part of the problem is the PM is actually 80 megawatt, whereas PE was 50 megawatt. So at that time, find the rotor acceleration. Rotor acceleration means d square delta by dt square. So accelerating power, we can find it as PA is equal to PM minus PE, which is 30 megawatt here. Because it is 80 minus 50, it is 30 megawatt. So as per swing equation, we can write M into d square delta by dt square is equal to PA. So from this, if we know M, we can find d square delta by dt square. But we know the equation for M as GH by 180F. So GH is found as 800. So 800 divided by 180 into 50, which is equal to 4 by 45 megajoule second per electrical degrees. So substituting for M as 4 by 45 in this equation, we can write 4 by 45 into d square delta by dt square is equal to 30. Or else d square delta by dt square, which is nothing but the alpha. We'll get it as 337.5 electrical degrees per second square. So that is the second part of the problem. And the third part, the acceleration calculated is maintained for 10 cycles. Then find the torque angle, change in torque angle, delta, delta, and the rotor speed in RPM. So we need a conversion there. No, it's given that it is maintained for 10 cycles. So 10 cycles means it's equivalent to, in seconds, we could say 50 cycles per second. So 10 cycles will corresponding to 0.2 second. So change in delta, d delta, which is equal to half into alpha into delta t square. So half into alpha, you know, delta t, you know. So we'll get it as 6.75 electrical degrees. And to convert it into revolutions in RPM, no, you know that one revolution is equal to 2 pi radian mechanical. So when we convert it into electrical, it will become 2 pi into p by 2 radian electrical. So in this particular problem, p by 2 is 2 actually. So we'll get it as 4 pi radian electrical. And if it is expressed in degrees, it will be equivalent to 2 pi is equivalent to 360. So 4 pi means 2 into 360. Okay. And we know that we have found earlier that alpha is 337.5. So alpha, here it is in electrical degrees per second square, can be converted to RPM per second by multiplying with 60 by 2 into 360, this term. Okay. RPM revolutions per minute. So seconds to minute, it is 60 here. So alpha will be equal to 337.5 multiplied by 60 divided by 2 into 360 degree. So it will be 28.125 RPM per second. And you are asked to find what is the rotor speed at the end of 10 cycles. Now the speed of machine is, synchronous speed is 120 F by P, 120 into 50 by 4 plus alpha into delta T. So it will be plus alpha is 28.125 RPM per second for the time duration of 0.2 seconds. So it will be 28.125 into 0.2. So we'll get it as 1505.625 RPM. Hope you understood that problem. Move on to the next. A 400 MVA synchronous machine has H1 is equal to 4.6 megajoules per MVA and a 1200 MVA machine has H2 is equal to 3 megajoule per MVA. The two machines operate in parallel in a power plant. Find out H equivalent relative to a 100 MVA base. So how will you do this? So what all parameters are given? Here it is H1 is given, similarly G1 is given, G2 is given and H2 is given. So already a system base is given as 100 MVA. So G1, H1, G2, H2, G is given. Now the equation H equivalent is equal to G1 machine by G system into H1 machine plus G2 machine by G system into H2 machine. Simply substitute on it, you get H equivalent. The same can be done in many ways. Means total kinetic energy of two machines we can find. GH into G1 H1 into G2 H2. So you'll get it as this much. 5,440 megajoules. And the equivalent inertia relative to a 100 MVA base will be H equivalent. Will be kinetic energy divided by system base. No, H. So it will be 5440 divided by 100. You'll get it as 54.4 megajoule per MVA. And these are the references for this module 6. Thank you.